And I think restorative practices can be one of the framework what allows us to talk about emotions, about how we are affected by all this crisis around us. And I would like to take you a little bit through my own journey, to start with my own journey, why I'm using restorative practices, then to show what it is or to give some definitions, and then to come with some examples so we can see what can resonate with us. I started as a social science and philosophy teacher in Romania, very young, very optimistic, and too naive to trust that it's okay to talk freely. So I found myself in a situation which resulted in being a refugee, a political refugee with my child. And coming to Hungary, I spent a few weeks in a camp for refugee, and I didn't care what kind of job I can take. I wanted to have this feeling of security for myself and my child. And the only place where they were able to provide housing and work was a juvenile detention center. And they were looking for a psychologist. Although I didn't have any practice in psychology at that time, just the theoretical part, I finished also the university as a psychologist in the Ceausescu era, which meant that we weren't really allowed to really practice psychology too much. But as a teacher, it was okay. So the juvenile detention center, the director of the juvenile detention center said, no worries, after 200-300 students, you will be a good professional because we have a lot of work to do here. And this is how I started. I wanted to be a good professional because I felt that I need to give something back to the country which hosted me and provided me security. So my first question was how to be a good professional in this institution. And they said, follow the job description. Do what we all will do. And this wasn't really enough for me, so this answer. So I started to do a research, a follow-up research with 500 students for 5 years and to see what is working and what it doesn't. And it came out that 75-80% of the students broke the law 3, 5, 4, 6 months after release. And when I interviewed them, it came out that even those who wanted to change their behavior, they were confronted with the labels, with the stigma, and with the fear of the community which where they wanted to belong. So I asked my bosses what to do, and they said, well, this is how it is, and we cannot change the system, we cannot change the environment. It's not our responsibility, it's not our job to do this. We have to keep the security within the institution. But I couldn't cope with this because I felt, and this is where the emotions will play a lot of, will play a big role. So I tried to understand what is going on, what is happening. And the answer came by engaging more people, giving more voice, giving more choice. And I didn't know at that time that this is something what is called in the word restorative justice. I learned later about Nils Christie, a Norwegian criminologist, who saw the conflict as property. And he said that we have to give back the conflict to their owners because they are the experts of their conflicts. So this is how I got involved with restorative practices. I got a scholarship in US to learn how it works in the practice. And after 1 year, I came back and I tried to make changes. I was told again that it's too naive. We are not Americans. They are different. We are different. We won't share emotion. We cannot do anything. So I quit my job and I set up an organization to prove that is working because I had my own experience and my own involvement in a process which led me to understand that in order to be successful, and they were successful, their rate of success were 85%. So I said that we have to try this, even if it's culturally different in a different context. So since 2001, I'm working as a professional, as a practitioner professional in different fields, from schools to communities to justice system. And in the last couple of years, I was invited by the Ministry of Justice in Romania to talk about restorative practices. So I think that was a healing process for me to be able to go back in and restore also the self-esteem, because it's not a good feeling to be a refugee, but also to provide something new for the community. So that's my journey. And now I would like to give some short background about how we view restorative practices. And as I mentioned, it came from the justice point of view. In the 70s, when we heard that this the loss of security, the ontological, the feeling of security started to be spread around the world, restorative justice was one answer from the criminal justice point of view. And the point was to give people voice, create a space where discussions are possible, and when the stories are heard, people can transform their attitude toward each other. So involving victims, offenders, their communities, the larger community was really the point. And that led to the idea that this can transform the relationships from a hate-related conversation. We can be more open, and even we can feel empathy towards each other if we know we know that it's not a demon, it's a person behind the act. A lot of experiments around the world started to show that this idea has a transformational effect. It can transform relationships, it can transform the connections between people, and really can heal the emotional injuries. Because any harm will create an injury, not just physical, moral, emotional, and so on. And these harms create needs, individual needs, and also community needs. And if we are very explicit in what we are going to do and how and why we are going to do, this is something what will allow people to understand what are the needs, to respond to the individual needs and repair some of the harm. Not everything can be repaired, of course, but the research shows that at least 50% of the harm which was done won't be repeated. And that gave us a lot of food for our soul and for our research. And it was good to see that on the international level, where the legislation made it possible to intervene from a restorative point of view, we saw that it has a psychological impact. Being afraid of offender, it's normal, but when we have the chance to meet face to face and to understand the environment and see the person regret or remorse or even more emotion shared by the community which supported that person, then the fear will diminish. The same with the anger. Before, we want our feelings to be heard, but when we talk about them, the anger will diminish again. And more than that, and you can see that there are research from Australia to Europe towards America and so on. So it's a good sign that it's a universal need to have the voice and have the meeting face to face and to talk about what happened. Because if this can happen, then we can even feel sympathy. And that was something what raised the issue of the question of can we use all this idea in a daily base on our daily life? And the answer, yes. Because if we think that the education has a huge role in developing the sense of identity as well, then we can understand why it's important to start from an early age to engage people, to build relationships, to strengthen the community through participatory learning and decision making. So because if we take Niels Christie's idea that people are the owners of their own conflicts and they are the experts of their own conflicts, that means that we can create the space from an early age to talk about this expertise in a way which doesn't affect in a negative way, but in a way which creates the connection. The fundamental hypothesis of restorative practices is that people are more happier or more secure, or their feeling of security is more higher and more productive if those who are in position of authority will take decisions with them, not to them or for them. Of course, we need the high control and high support, but if we can do both, to be very explicit about what are the demands, but also to be very sure that the person will be supported to make the necessary changes, then the change will start because everyone can interiorize what needs to happen to make things right. Shortly, I will say that I can say that restorative practices, in fact, it's a science of developing relationships and community as a response to fundamental human needs. The need to belong, so to have connection, the need to have a voice, so people can be sure that your story is heard and you can feel that it's okay to be vulnerable, and also to have agency. And we heard yesterday about the role of the agency. Without agency, even if we know what should be done, we won't be able to feel that this is our journey and we can be creators of our journeys as well. So now coming to the day-by-day practice, I started to develop some experiments based on what I learned in US, coming home and trying to implement restorative practices. And not just me, but many others realized that this is a tool which can be used in the classroom situation or in the foster homes or children homes or community of children and campuses. Bringing people together and trying to teach them effective statements. And these effective statements, when they allowed the free expression of feelings, but minimizing the negative and increasing the need to develop a common vision, allowed people to take responsibility for what is going on in that community. Results were very clear that we'll reduce absenteeism because of the feeling of belonging. We'll create the sense of a healthy community because everyone can know that it will be my turn also today to share what is going on. And less harm and more responsibility, shared responsibility was viewed within this context. So this is how we went further. Although it came from the criminal justice system, we realized that, as I shared it with my experience, that we have somehow to bridge the gap between the inside world and outside world, and bringing people together, for example, before a release from the prison, allowed people from a community to talk about their fears, but also allowed the offenders, the inmates, to realize what are the effects of their decisions. And if it was done well, the person was able to make the distinction between the person and the act. And that was, again, something what we had to learn, that if we label people, it's very hard to make changes. And I think this has a lot of implication for us as well. So bringing, for example, a family and the community, and also having the director of the prison in the same circle gives a lot of trust that change is possible if we work together and if we respect each other's life and each other's decision, if the decision has a positive effect on the others as well. For a second I go back, it took us 10 years in the prison of Balassagyarmat, which is in north of Hungary, to experiment with restorative practices, but finally, after 10 years of successful outcomes, the legislation changed. So we can have an impact, I think, on the processes around us. More recent work is done with the people who are vulnerable or are in a very critical situation. There are projects of social inclusion, for example, in Cluj. There is a place, Pataret, where the whole trash from the city is stored, and 3,000 people are living there for decades. And this is Europe. In a two-year project, we were able to help 10% of them, but I think it's also a success. But also it shows that it's going to be a very long process to restore the self-esteem and to build an identity which allows the people who were raised there to feel that they can belong to a city or to a community. It's like restoring somehow the failed citizenship into a successful citizenship. The same strategy we use in the camp for refugee, for example, in Belgium, where I was a volunteer, to see how does a community around of a camp for refugee can accept that people want to do some volunteer work. While they were waiting for their papers, they wanted to do something, but the fear of the community was too high, so the only way what helped us to bring people together was to create spaces where we can have informal meetings with each other, and this space was based on the basic needs, sharing the food. And that allowed people to start to open the discussion with each other. In the picture on the right side, you see a boy from Afghanistan who said that this was great because he never thought that people from Syria and Afghanistan and Lebanon can share a table and share their food. But the big learning for us was that we had to provide the structure. We had to model the way of communication in order to build a common understanding of what means a good and healthy relationship. The latest example is from Transylvania, so I'm back now in Romania and working on restoring what can be restored. Psychologists and teachers are working now on the field with children mainly and their parents to talk about the ethnical tensions, to talk about the trauma, the transgenerational trauma, and to try to share or develop a common vision.
Just so, a second, unfortunately, yeah. Mr. Takács has to leave. He didn't want to disturb you.
2 minutes. 2 minutes, okay. I'm here for the... Again, we had time to read a little bit this conclusion. So the narrative of hope is more and more visible, and we can hear that from the people who are engaged in these processes. The most powerful for me, there are a lot of powerful feedbacks about those from those who are engaged in such a process. But what you can see, it's a supervision for 65 people. I know it's crazy, but we came together, people. We brought together people from prison, from education, and from community to see what happened after these projects. And because if the financial support starts, a lot of occasions the projects will stop. But if we engage people from an emotional point of view as well, then they will continue. And they will continue because they believe that this is the way how can they have an impact on the larger society. As a conclusion, restorative practices is meant to create a space, a safe space, usually in a circle format, where we can talk about what happened, who and how is affected, and what needs to happen to move forward or to make things right. We don't ask why happened, because it's a blaming response. It creates the field for blame or for a polarization. And in order to achieve this type of conversation, we have to build a structure from an individual connection, which is based on the affective statements, towards a more formal, structured format, which now, for example, in Netherlands or Ireland, is shown by the citizen assemblies or community processing, where the decisions are made not to them, not for them, but with them. So it's a long process, but it's doable. So the mission is possible. And it has to be possible because we are responsible for the new generation. So thank you.